Your name?
Earl Lamont.
Hi, I'm Drew.
Glad to meet you, Drew. Hoover was president. And when Roosevelt came along in 32, he did a lot of things that my dad liked. My dad was just a poor working guy.
Yeah.
And he did a lot of things. My dad thought Roosevelt was next to God. Well, there was he wasn't by himself. There was quite a few people like that. But you know, there was all kinds of things like, for instance, they gave away food, you know, excess food and stuff. They give it away now to people that don't even need it. But then they'd give like raisins or apples, but my dad wouldn't let us take anything. He didn't believe in it.
So he was the attitude, basically, you only take what you earn.
Yeah, that's right. You know, it was we didn't know how poor we were. You know, you don't know. You grow up in a place.
I don't know, did you grow up on like at a farm or?
A small farm, yeah.
No, because my grandma was like that. She grew up on a small farm. You didn't really know you were poor, even though the depression was.
No, and my mother would say, you see that house up on the hill there? It would be a big house. You know, she said, those people, they're not happy. That was her thing. I guess that satisfied her. And to think that way, but CCCs, yeah, well, that's a civilian conservation corps. It was young guys didn't have a job, and they could go in there, and I guess they gave them a little money,
$30, which they had to send 25 home.
Yes, that's exactly.
And they
right.
have $5 to spend on whatever they want.
Right, and they had uniforms. And, you know, they had a place to sleep and everything, so they got along okay. But I don't remember too much about it except what I told you, that they would service campgrounds and work on projects. One project that impressed me that I didn't see then, I saw as an adult, is a roadway down through the Carolinas, built in the Depression. Maybe I'll think of it in a little while.
Like the Blue Ridge Mountains, or?
Yeah. It's the Blue Ridge Parkway, I believe, is the name of it. And that's a wonderful place. And that was built by people in the Depression.
Yep.
And they built the airport there in Nashua. They built parks, but I can't tell you too much about the CCCs, except that was a good thing to have at the time.
Because all the testimony I've read, just universal praise for just turned guys into men.
Say that again now.
It just turned young people into men.
Yes. But it filled a gap there for guys didn't have jobs, and you know, and people were poor then, you know, at least where I was. I mean, when you went to school, they had things like they would give you some extra food, or you know, that the government paid for, surplus food.
Well, the thinking was, if a farmer is going to lose money because nobody was going to buy his produce,
yeah,
it was better that the government bought it, saved the farmer, and then gave it to people who didn't have work.
Yeah.
So it kind of killed two birds with one stone.
Oh, yeah.
Saved the farmer and kept people alive.
Yeah. Well, you had the all kinds of programs, of course, from Roosevelt. The NRA, that was a big deal. National Rehabilitation Act, I think that's pretty close to what they called it. And NRA was a big deal in the 30s. And then, you know, there was things like, I remember when electricity came through, I was just a little kid. And
was that through the Rural Electrification Act?
Yes, exactly, REA. And I can remember all I can remember mainly is it was really a tight situation. Nobody had any money. My dad was making about 12 bucks a week, and he worked six nights, 12 hours as a night watchman. And so, you know, I can remember, say, Dad, can we go fishing sometime? He'd say, well, no, I can't because I only have one day off, and I've got this has got to be fixed, and that's got to be done. And I'm lucky to have a job, he'd say, even though it was 12 hours a night, 6 days a week, and got $12. And then with Roosevelt, I don't remember the exact deal, but with Roosevelt, he got more money and way less hours. And, you know, so that made it Roosevelt a hero to him. And anyway.
Well, I don't know. Do you know anyone in particular who actually who went to work on any of the projects?
Yeah, my uncle worked on WPA. He worked on the airport project quite a while.
Nashua?
In Nashua, yeah. Yeah. And I remember, and I was probably about 8 or 9 before the war. And I was hanging around up there, and a guy gave me a ride in a Ryan trainer. It's two-seated. Two separate seats, And he's flying from the front seat. He gave me a ride in the back seat, and I thought that was a really big deal. And anyway, and bridges. I don't know how that was handled, but we had a covered bridge that went from Hudson to Nashua. Hudson was a little town across the river, Merrimack River, from Nashua. And they took that down. Well, they didn't take it down at first. They built a bridge next to it.
It wasn't taken out by some of the floods? Because I know, like, 38, I think, was one of the big ones? Or
I remember it well. Remember very well. But they took the covered bridge. They replaced it before that, early 30s. I just barely remember it. They built a bridge side of it, you know, then they demolished the covered bridge.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a big deal, nice cement bridge, you know. Anyhow, the floods in 38, I think it was 36, I think.
Yes, 36.
Yeah, 36 was, that was
a, that was, that was the hurricane, wasn't it?
No, 38 was the hurricane.
And then, yeah, 36 was the floods.
Yeah, but there was another flood when we had the hurricane. But it wasn't as bad as that 36. The 36 one was terrible where I was at. People that had farms along the Merrimack River there, they were wiped out. Their houses were wiped out. I can remember women crying there, you know, they're sitting up on the hill seeing their house float away. I mean, it was terrible.
Because I only see about it when I read, like, the old town reports.
Yeah.
And they talk about, or they at least list that, you know, the WPA kicked in money or did, you know, deployed manpower to do reconstruction.
Right.
Because the main thing, especially after the hurricane and all the trees got blown down.
Oh, yeah. Oh, it went right through where I was, Dad. Yeah. We had, I was home alone that night. I was 9 years old, and I was home alone, and I was watching it from outside. I saw my neighbor's house was on the side of a hill go over. All the trees. In fact, afterwards, the lakes were full of trees. You know, they took the logs and put them in the lakes to keep them. And you couldn't go fishing in a couple of the lakes because they were full of trees, you know. You couldn't
Well, the fear was, you know, this was just a huge fire hazard by all having all these dead trees.
Yeah, yeah. Well, anyhow, like I said, I was home alone. My mother and father were in Nashua, and they couldn't come home because the bridge, it was a flood at the same time.
Yeah.
The bridge was closed. So you had to go to Kingsborough, which was about 10, 12 miles down the river, or to Manchester, which is about 18 miles up the river to get across. So they got home the next day. And I don't remember just exactly what happened, but I know this. Kingsborough, we went down there a few days later, and from Kingsborough on up to Hudson, there's the trees were, they were like they were cut off at the roadway, you know, they're laying down on both sides. It was like a path through cut trees. That's how many trees were down. It just would wipe out them, all of them, you know. It wasn't just one here and there. And I saw, remember I was telling you about this bridge they built to replace the covered bridge. Now this is what we thought was a wonderful new modern bridge. And I saw a house come down the river and crash into the railing. The railing was cement too. And crash into the railing and made a hole there because it had reinforcement wire in it. And I can remember when I left there, that hole was still, when I left there, I joined the Army when I was 17, birthday. And when I left, it still had that hole there. And now that bridge is gone, and there's another bridge to replace that one. And I worked in the mills. When I was 14, I went to work in the mills. The war was on. I probably weighed about 90 pounds. And I went to Nashua Mills, and I went to the employment department, whatever they called it then. And I told them I was 16, and I said, okay, we can use you, and you're going to have your father sign. I said, well, give me the paper. So I signed the paper, and I worked from 3 to 11 shift after school. I was a bobbin boy.
These are like woolen mills?
Textile mills. We had products like Dwight Anchor sheets, Pepperell blankets. Anyhow, it's a
war production mills.
Well, we weren't when I worked on it. There was not any war production that I know of. But I was only in one mill in one finishing department, and I don't know what all went. 3,500 people worked there.
Okay.
3,500 people worked in that mill. Then up the river 18 miles, every time you turn on the TV to see the boating deal in Manchester, I forgot now where it was. But anyway, they showed Manchester a lot, and they'll show, interview somebody, and in the background is this red building, it looks like a red brick building. That was the longest mill in the world. It was over a mile long. It's Amistad Mills in New Hampshire. That was there when I was a boy. And of course, they're not mills anymore. That is textile.
No.
And same in Nashua. They moved south. After I went in the service in 1946, Textron bought them and they moved it south in the Carolinas or somewhere. And
by the way, did you have any unions then?
Yes, we had a union. You bet we did. I'll tell you a union story.
Well, that was part of the reason for moving south, because they were anti-union down there.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I went, I had this job, bobbin boy in the mill, which roughly it just encompasses getting the bobbins down that got yarn on them and distributing them to girls on another machine that wound them onto a spool that went to a slasher machine. Anyway, I worked there only 2 or 3 weeks, and the last thing I had to do before I clocked out at 11 was sweep the area and make everything neat in my area. I had about 7 or 8 girls that I had to service with my job. And so this one night, the bobbin boy and the next group of machines didn't show up that night. And so the mechanic that serviced those machines was sweeping up the area where the bobbin boy would have done before 11. And so I saw him doing this, and I thought, I'll go over and sweep for him, because he's got an important man, you know. And I was all, my area was all done. So I went over there, and I was told him I'd sweep it for him, and I'm starting to sweep up the area, and a second hand, a big guy, big French guy, that weighed at least twice what I did, come over there, he picked me up by the scruff of the neck, and he says, "Get your ass back over where you belong and don't ever do that again," he said. That's how the union was, you know.
Yeah.
And you had to join a union. You had to join within 90 days or something. I had, so it was a AF of LCIO, or I don't remember now.
They didn't form, I don't know. I forget which date when they formed, because they used to be separate.
Yeah, yeah. But whatever it was, that's the only time in my life I joined a union. I wasn't schooled in unions. My dad didn't like unions, and so I didn't.
But that's funny, because Roosevelt gave them the right to organize.
Oh, yeah. I know, but my dad said unions didn't do any good for him, and they didn't do any good for me. I had another job later. No. Earlier, when I was 12. When I was 12, I went to a cabinet shop. So I would be, that would be in 1941. It was a cabinet shop that they employed about 20 people. And I wanted a job. So I went down there, and the man was 90-something years old that owned and run that shop. And he was a big man, about 6 foot tall, which was big in those days. And he was a kind man and a good, but a businessman. And so I went in and I said, "Mr. Petty, I want a job." I'd probably come up to his waist, you know. And I could, first my impression of him was funny. All his fingers were the same length.
Uh-oh.
From cutting them off.
Oh.
Anyway, I said, "Mr. Petty, I'd like to have a job." So he treated me like a person, you know. And he says, "What can you do?" You know. And I said, "I'm a good nailer." And he says, "How'd you learn to nail?" I said, "Well, working with my dad." He said, "What'd your dad do?" I said, "Well, he builds houses once in a while. He'll build a house." And he did. He built several houses in that town. And he said, does your dad know that you're here?" And I said, "No." And he says, "Well, if I call him up, will he say it's okay for you to work?" I said, "Yes, he will." And he says, "Well," he says, "I've got a job nailing apple boxes, and if you want to nail apple boxes, I'll try you out. The pay is 25 cents an hour. And you can start tomorrow."
What year was this?
1941. So I went down there, and there was only one other kid worked there, and he was 16 years old, about twice as big as me. But all the others were older men, and you know, they hadn't gone to war, in fact, there probably wasn't anybody there less than 50 years old. So, anyway, I went to nailing apple boxes. Well, it turned out that I was a star at nailing apple boxes. So, the first week when I got paid, he gave me 35 cents an hour instead of 25.
Oh.
I thought that was a big deal. You know, I thought that was wonderful. And he lived there. He used to work in the morning. He'd come in and he'd work whatever he needed to be done in the shop. Or he might work in his office filing saws. He did all the sharpening of the saws and everything. And anyhow, and he lived there with his wife. So, you know, years went by. I worked there for a couple of years, part-time and in the all summer, and before I worked in the mill. And had this other kid that worked there was 16 years old. His name was Rocky, and he liked to torment the older guys. He'd go and shuffle up their work that they had laid out, you know, or work they'd just done, and it's put aside in certain ways, side of their saw, and he'd ruffle them up, and he'd just tick off the old guys, you know. And so he didn't like me because I was a star, see, this little shit kid.
Yeah,
he's a star. So he didn't like me, and he's always trying to torment me. And of course, I was scared the hell out of me because he was twice as big as me. He was a good-sized kid. And anyway, this went on for probably 6 months or so. And one day, one of the older guys had taken me at lunch. We went down to the store and got some ice cream. We'd get a pint of ice cream for 15 cents. And once in a while, we'd do that. And come back, and Rocky come in on his bicycle and ran into me, of course, on purpose. Well, as luck would have it, you know, he bailed out and he's ready to fight. So I got a hold of him. And I never let him go. I had him around the neck, and I never let him go. And he struggled, and he was, of course, losing his air, you know. And so all the old guys, you know, they're standing around there watching this. And Mr. Petty came out, and he stood there a while, and sees this. And of course, everybody knows that Rocky's got this coming, see, because he terrorizes the old guys. So anyway, finally Mr. Petty says, oh, that's enough, break him up. Well, I thought, sure, that Rocky was going to kill me after that, you know, because I made him look like nothing.
You embarrassed him.
Yeah. But he was afraid of me. He was afraid of me after that.
Well, good for you.
Yeah. So anyway, you know, like a couple of weeks went by, and one day I'm on the other side of the partition, but there's old Dutchman there off. Rocky went in there, and he's going to torment him, to shuffle his work around or something, you know. And I heard off telling me, he says, hey, Rocky, I know a little kid that can whip your ass. He says, you get away. And Rocky, he stopped commenting.
Yay.
And
you saved the day.
Yeah, I remember that very well. But anyway, that's we did have some war work there. We made torpedo crates. And we made marker boxes that held a marker stone, you know, to go over to the foreign countries like France, where they had big graves, big graveyards for...
Well, a lot of people shifted from consumer production to war production, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And I worked for another one for a short while. They were winding cables. They were went to the shipyard in Boston. And my dad worked in the Navy. But anyhow, no, like I can tell you, our mortgage was $18.25 a month, our payment on our mortgage on our farm, $18.25. And one time, my mother sent me to the post office.
Hold on just a second.
She sent me to the post office to buy a money order to send the mortgage payment. So she had $20 bill. And I was only about 6 years old. So, and she says, now, you buy a money order, and you got to put it in the envelope, you know. And when you're done with the postage and everything, you'll have a dollar and a quarter. Says you'll have a dollar bill and a quarter. Make sure you got that, you know. So I went to the post office, and it was a lady. It's a small town. The lady was the postmistress, and she was the only one there. So I bought the money order and did everything, and I knew I had the dollar and a quarter, so I went home. About 2 miles to walk down there. I was about 6 years old. I got home, and my mother says, well, you've got the $20 bill that I gave you. So I didn't know. All I knew was I had a dollar and a quarter. But she'd given me the 20 back. So.
Okay, I'll be right back.
That's okay. That's okay. So anyhow, I get home, and I know I got the dollar and a quarter, but I've got the 20 that she sent me with. So it's 2 miles back to the post office. So I says, do I bring it back now? And she said, no, I don't want you to bring it back now. She says, your father will be home about 5 o'clock, and he'll take you down. So when my dad came home, mother told him about it. So my father says, get in the car, and we went to the post office. And we went in the door and went to the window, and Mrs. Clyde, I still remember her name. My dad says, Mrs. Clyde, my son came down here this morning to buy a money. She says, now we don't make any mistakes. he had his money. We got the right change. He don't make any mistakes. I don't want to hear about it. And so my father says, okay. And then he took me by the hand, and we went out and went to the car. We got in the car, and we were driving along, and I said, Dad, you always told me to be honest. I says, what happened here? And he says, I told you to be honest. I didn't tell you to be a damn fool. Anyhow, that woman never spoke to me again. Never spoke, because she, of course, found she was shot that night, probably, you know.
Uh-huh.
Never spoke to me again. But I was trying to illustrate one thing there. One was $18 and a quarter was the mortgage. And it was a different time in this world. You know, you did things different. In the same area, we had a grocery store and a little millinery store. And one day my mother gave me $0.50 to go to get some hamburger, 25 cents worth of hamburger. Top of the round grounds is what she wanted, 25 cents worth. And gave me $0.50 to go. So I go down there, and they had a boardwalk in front of the stores there. And the boards had a little space between them. And I was headed for the grocery store, and I dropped the $0.50, and sure enough, it went through a crack, down through the crack, so it's gone. So I knew the man in the store, Roland. He was a young guy, and he was a real nice guy, and he was good with kids and everything, you know. I was probably about, I know it's before we moved from that house, so I was about 8 years old. And so I went in, and I saw Roland. He cut meat. He was a meat cutter and the store manager. And I told him, I says, I came down to get 25 cents worth of top of the round ground. But I dropped the $0.50 in the boardwalk. So he says, I said, I can't go home. He says, well, you wait a minute. So he went and he got a hammer and a crowbar and he come out and he said, you know where that half dollar went down? I says, right here. So he took the, pulled up a couple of boards, got the half a dollar, and I got my hamburger and a quarter change and went home. And you know, imagine somebody doing that today. That's the way things work.
So you grew up in New Hampshire?
New Hampshire. And my dad.
What town?
Hudson is the name of the town.
Okay, because I've been studying all the stuff in New Hampshire because I'm from Maine.
Oh, well, Nashua. You know where Nashua is?
Yeah.
Okay. What part of Maine?
Madison, just a little town out in, on 201.
I haven't been there since I was 16 years old, so relate it to something place else.
It's next to Skowhegan, which is next to Waterville.
Well, that shows you I don't know nothing.
Okay.
Are you inland?
Inland, yeah.
Okay. And closer to New Hampshire or closer to
Canada? Yeah, Central Maine.
Central Maine. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. North Conway. It's right on the border of Maine and New Hampshire. Anyway, we camped there this night. The next morning, we're going to go over, I think it's Hurricane Mountain. And it goes, when you go over the mountain, you're into Maine. So we had an old, about a 35 Chevy or something with mechanical brakes.
Isn't that where the Grand Trunk used to go through?
The which?
The Grand Trunk Railroad used to go through there?
Well, I don't know where the railroad was. But this was just from North Conway. You go over a mountain. I think it's Hurricane Mountain. It's not a real high mountain, you know. But you can drive over it. And anyway, I'm driving down the other side, and the brakes gave out. And they get hot, you know, they gave out, and I couldn't stop the car, and there was curves in the road and everything. And so at any moment, I'm figuring I'm going to go into a tree or a big rock, because it's all I can do to control the thing. You know?
Did your car have seatbelts?
Oh, no, there was no seatbelt.
So you figured you'd be going through a window soon.
And finally, when I know I can't, I've got no more strength, keep it going. And there's three other kids in the car.
Uh-oh.
And I got no more strength to go. The road straightened out, and we were down at the bottom of the mountain, and we were going into Maine. So we went into Maine. I don't remember how far, but let's say it's 2 or 3 miles, 4 or 5 miles. And there was a gas station there on the left-hand side, and we were going to be needing some gas, so we stopped to get gas. There was nobody in the gas station, and there was a sign, pump your gas, we have the money in the box.
Wow.
Can you believe that today?
Not really. You find that.
Jesus.
No, you find that. The typical gas station is you pump, and then you go inside and pay.
Yeah, but there's no place to pay here. There was a cigar box to put your money in. You pump your gas, you take...
Yeah, different times.
Unbelievable. I mean, who would believe that today, you know?
No, I have a friend who used to live in Japan, and that's very, very typical of just the honor system.
Yeah.
Like a little vegetable stand in a little village someplace. That's kind of typical there.
Right. Well, you know, a local thing, but... That's the only place in the world that I ever saw where you could pump your gas.
Yeah.
And they trust you to pay.
Yeah.
But I guess gas was about 20 cents a gallon, so we got a dollar's worth and put a dollar in the pot. But that was just a little side story that I wanted to tell you about.